Someone needs to do a mute all.
Okay.
Good morning, everybody. Are we starting?
Hi, Gwen. It's Donald. Yes, we're about to start.
I have all muted.
I think we may be just waiting for Reed in Anjou.
Julia seems to be playing, but we can't hear.
Which feed should I unmute?
Julia, because you can see her playing, but we can't hear.
I do not have a Julia listed.
Oh, it's now Anjou, you see.
Okay.
Sorry. Okay, it looks like it's unmuted, but...
Sorry, everyone, so you couldn't hear that on Zoom?
No, we couldn't.
Oh, because, yeah, this microphone was right up next to the organ. So I don't know why that didn't work. Well, thank you, Julia. We'll hope.
The screen that I have, Reed, is the 12th Sunday after Pentecost that's spotlighted here.
Yeah. Okay. I think, anyway, no, I think we'll, I'm sorry if you weren't able to hear the prelude by Julia. I hope the other music that we're doing from here will be able to be heard. So we'll check in with you as we continue. Okay. No, I don't think I did. Can we just... Yeah, let's do a little sound check. You could hear that?
Yes, yeah. We could.
Okay. I don't know why. But yeah, we're still working out our sound here.
Reed, do I need to spotlight you?
Yeah, Gary will. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Well, welcome everyone. God works in mysterious ways and we get our technology going together, but we are very glad to be here coming to you from Anjou United Church this morning. A very warm welcome to you all. You know me by now. My name is Reed Sherman. I have to repeat that for my congregation because I will be leaving on a sabbatical, which you'll hear more about as we move into this service today. So I don't want everyone to forget my name. Hey, I'm still coming back. And exciting things ahead, both for myself and I pray for the congregations of Trinity and Anjou as they move forward in faith during that time. There are many announcements in our community. And boy, I don't know. I don't have my iPhone in front of me. Sherry, what's going on that we need to?
Rosemary's screen. Oh, now you're open. We had Rosemary's share screen up there for quite a while.
Okay. Oh, I see myself. Hooray.
You're good.
Oh, or not hooray. we have a rally day coming up. Sherry, when is that? September the 11th. So we're hoping lots of young people will be coming back for Sunday school and a party afterwards. And let's pray for good weather for that. Our movie documentary filming at Trinity is wrapping up today, a long day of filming. We're thankful again for Ashley and Christine for being our eyes and ears at the church all this past week. And they'll be cleaning up over the next few days. So next Sunday, be back at Trinity, and that will be a blessing. Other announcements from our community. Hearing none, I would invite Margie to say hello from our friends at Wyman.
Sure, with pleasure. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our service. We're thankful to be here and thankful to see you all there. And let's have a blessed day.
And
thank you, Margie. Yeah. I guess it's my turn. Good morning, bon matin, on this beautiful sunny summer day. Bienvenue à toutes et à tous. Welcome to everyone worshiping together. This morning, as Margie said, what a blessing it is to be together. For our MRUC congregation, we have a couple of announcements which are also in our newsletter sent by email. First, a thank you from Betty and John Miller for the messages of sympathy following the death of their son, Greg. There's also a thank you and an au revoir from Susanna Klinker as she moves to Toronto to further her studies, and she'll be studying at U of T. The church office this week will be open Monday to Friday, and our minister David will be working from home for several days. Finally, we will continue to worship just online next Sunday, Labor Day Sunday, and we will return to our hybrid format on September the 11th, so we will be worshiping in person and online on September the 11th. And now let us listen to the land acknowledgement. Now, as we prepare for worship, let us acknowledge the land upon which we gather. For this land holds a long and rich history of occupation and stewardship by Indigenous peoples for millennia through to the present day. Indigenous people such as those from the Haudenosaunee and Anishinaabe nations have deep, strong historical ties to this land. Montreal has long served as a site of meeting and exchange among these various Indigenous groups. As we ourselves gather as a diverse community, we acknowledge and thank the diverse Indigenous peoples whose presence marks this territory on which peoples of the world now gather.
Thank you for those words, Margaret. And we turn to a hymn many of us love. Come in, and sit down. If you have a hymnal at home, it's number 395. We'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4. Please rise in the sanctuary as able.
come in and sit down. You are a part of the family. We are lost and we are found, and we are a part of the family. You know the reason why you came, yet no reason can explain. So share in the laughter and cry in the pain, for we are a part of the family. Come in and sit down. We are a part of the family. We are lost and we are found, and we are a part of the family. God is with us in this place, like a mother's warm embrace. We're all forgiven by God's grace, for we are a part of the family. Come in and sit down. You are a part of the family. We are lost and we are found, and we are a part of the family. Health and glory, the health for us all. There's a yoke that is easy and a burden that's small. And worship and answer the call, for we are a part of the family. Come in and sit down. You are a part of the family. We are lost and we are found, and we are a part of the family.
Amen. You may be seated. And let us join in our responsive call to worship as we offer these words. God bids us come to the banquet of life. God bids us come, but will there be enough seats? Will there be enough food? Will there be enough wine? God says, more than enough. Then where will I sit? At the head of the table, the place of honor? God says, each place is a place of honor. That sounds like a great invitation. Let us worship God.
Good morning, everyone. Please join me with your mics muted in our gathering prayer. Let us read together. Loving God, you have invited us to partake of the banquet of life. In this honor, we gather to take time to realize the vastness of the invitation to us and the wonders of the feast. Open our eyes in wonder. Open our eyes in awe, open our mouths in praise. In the name of the Christ we pray, amen. Please join me in our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
I believe we need a screen share here.
Just a moment.
I could try to screen share that if you like. Maybe I can't.
I think we're good, David. Thank you. Just a second.
Okay.
Rosemary is doing that sharing.
Yep.
There we go.
It's a beautiful hymn of faith on this beautiful day. Amen. Well, for the time for the kid and all of us today, I wrote kind of a bit of a letter to the young people of our community, and I thought our less young people might want to just overhear some words that I have to share with the young people at this time in our ministry here at Trinity and Anjou United Churches. So here goes. So for any young people here with us today, I want to introduce you to a big word that you don't get to hear every day. The word is sabbatical. A word that you likely hear more often are words like vacation, or holiday. A sabbatical is similar in that it involves taking time off from work to do other things. But a sabbatical in the church is special. That's because the word sabbatical has its root meaning in the word Sabbath. And Sabbath is a word we know in the church traditionally for Christians. It means Sunday. Sunday is our Sabbath day, our day that God gives us to rest from our usual work. Even if that means for kids, and I know you're back to school now, kids, sometimes you'll do a little bit of homework on Sunday night to prepare for class the next day. Sherry is a teacher and she's smiling from ear to ear here in the sanctuary. Kids, you probably know that, well, you and your teachers get to take the summers off. Sometimes teachers rest during that time, but others will do different types of work if there is a need until school starts again. And I hope everyone, all of us who work, take days or get weeks to be on holiday. We all need to take a break. But a sabbatical is a bit different. It's an extended time to learn something new, to have a new experience that will help you and others learn and grow in faith. So in church, a minister is encouraged to take a sabbatical every 7 years. It's a time of 3 months to live, and here's what I like. So Sabbath sabbatical, I'm thinking of this sabbatical as a time to live every day as if it was a Sunday. I'm going to be going on sabbatical in just a few days on September 1, and I'm coming back in January. One place I'm going to spend some time, and Rosemary's going to show us a slide, and I have also here the building that you see in the picture, and the one I'm showing in my camera is the Abbey of Iona. And Iona is an island, a small island off the west coast of Scotland. It's been there for a long, long time. Originally, it was founded back in the year 563 by a man who's known as Saint Columba. He came over from Ireland to bring Christianity to Scotland. So the building and the community were there for, you know, hundreds of years, but then the way of all things, it fell into disrepair. And in 1938, a man named George MacLeod decided to revive that community and to rebuild that church. And since then, Christians of all kinds from all over the world go there to be inspired, to seek justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with God. It's a center for Celtic spirituality, and I can't wait to experience it. So I'll be there for 2 weeks in October, living with other guests and the community members there. We'll worship together several times a day. We'll eat our meals together. We're gonna do chores together. Who likes to do chores? Oh boy, peeling potatoes, washing a floor. You know what I mean. It's all a way to serve God as we serve each other. And by the way, kids, when you help your mom and dad, your guardian at home, you're being a humble servant with them and serving them, which is such a great idea. So I must say I feel humbled to have this chance to be on sabbatical. And I think everyone should get the chance to not just take a holiday, but have enough paid time off to really rest, to really play, eh? To really think and reflect and to grow. That would be something great for Canada to work on for everyone. And I'm going to be missing seeing all of you here at home, here in the sanctuary, all of you. But you know, it's going to go by fast, and I'll be back before you know it. So I'm going to miss everyone. I will hold each of you close in my heart, and I will be praying for all of you, each one. And might you pray for me too. I hope you'll also here at home learn new things, grow and experience each day as a gift God gives. So can you all do that for me? Woohoo! Thank you. And I can't wait to hear all about it when I get back. So thanks for listening, and I will see you again soon. Amen. So as part of my going on sabbatical, I'm going to invite our chair of Trinity Council, Sabs Heffernan, to come in over Zoom. Carlos Luis Santana is here from the Anjou board, and Philip Mazzarelli will join us in a moment. And thank you to the communities of Mount Royal and Hudson as we do a little bit of this needed business. I don't think it'll take long. And God bless you for being part of this also.
People of God, by virtue of our baptism, God calls us to mission and ministry and to holy labor in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. At certain times, God also calls us to occasions of Sabbath rest and reflection so that we might be renewed for Christian service. God traces our journeys and resting places. God will preserve our going out and our coming in.
From this time forth and forevermore.
Let us pray. God of all wisdom, send your blessings on your congregations as we enter this time of our ministers' sabbatical. Guide our leaders through challenges that may arise. Give to all of us discerning and prayerful hearts, spirits ready to understand and quick to forgive, ears to listen for your word and voices to speak the truth. Make us bold to live out your gospel as we seek to do your will. Amen.
Amen.
Reed, are you ready to step away from the obligations of daily church life and to engage in this period of sabbatical? Will you take time for reflection and renewal and rest in the life-giving experiences that await you?
I will, with God's help.
Members and friends of Trinity and Anjou communities of faith, in this time of sabbatical, will you support your leaders? Will you share in the mutual ministry that Christ has given to all who are baptized? Will you pray for them and for Reverend Reed on his sabbatical journey?
We will, with God's help.
Thank you. Philip the mic.
These words are inspired from a sabbatical guide for pastors at soulshepherds.org. Let us pray. Dear God, thank you for being in our presence this morning as we bear witness to this commissioning of Reverend Reed Sherman, Biblical Sabbatical. This will be the beginning of a new challenge for Reed. His calling to shepherd others will have to be adapted. It is a time for Reed to rest and become closer to God. So we pray that Reed will learn to train in extended solitude and silence with Jesus, and that he overcomes his natural desire to be pastoring, leading others, and planning sermons. Let us all pray for Reed as his body and mind start to understand the Sabbath rest as do nothing. Don't try to make anything happen. Just be with God. Eventually, his body will stop jittering. His thoughts will stop flitting about. He will begin to feel his emotions being nourished by this new experience before God. Pray with him now that he experiences this new opportunity of true rest of body and soul. I'm gonna look at you now. Put these words of Psalm 23 to the test. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. Restore your soul, Reed. Your journey of restoration begins during this time of reflection and new experiences with the Lord as your shepherd. Take time for praying and soul care. We anticipate your return in the new year. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. Amen. Thank you so much.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
And we've unmuted June James, and we'll continue with our first reading.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
The scripture is taken from Jeremiah chapter 2, verses 4 to 7 and 11 to 13. Hear the word of the Lord, O house of Jacob, and all the families of the house of Israel. Thus says the Lord, what wrong did your ancestors find in me that they went far from me and went after worthless things and became worthless themselves? They did not say, where is the Lord who brought us up from the house? Where is the Lord who brought us up from the land of Egypt, who led us in the wilderness, in a land of deserts and pits, in a land of drought and deep darkness, in a land that no one passes through, where no one lives? I brought you into a plentiful land to eat its fruits and its good things. But when you entered, you defiled my land and made my heritage an abomination. Has a nation changed its gods, even though they are no gods? But my people have changed their glory for something that does not profit. Be appalled, O heavens, at this. Be shocked. Be utterly desolate, says the Lord. For my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living water, and dug cisterns for themselves, cracked cisterns that can hold no water. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word.
In Luke chapter 14, the author collects teachings of Jesus that relate to the theme of humility as a characteristic of living God's kingdom on earth. Let's listen now to a reading from Luke chapter 14, verses 1 and 7 to 14. Hear these words. On one occasion, when Jesus was going to the house of a leader of the Pharisees to eat a meal on the Sabbath, they were watching him closely. When he noticed how the guests chose the place of honor, he told them a parable. When you are invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not sit down at the place of honor in case someone more distinguished than you has been invited by your host. And the host who invited both of you may come and say to you, give this person your place. And then in disgrace, you would start to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit down at the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he may say to you, friend, move up higher. Then you will be honored in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted.
Thank you so much, June and Andrea, for that reading of our Holy Scripture this morning. Would you pray with me, please? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be a witness, O God, to your way of love, justice, and faithful walking with us. Amen. I don't know exactly what was going on in the city yesterday. As I was driving east on Rachel and then Sherbrooke coming to Anjou yesterday, I noticed a line of cars coming the other way that seemed to be never ending. The streets flowing west into the city were full. An hour or two later, on my return trip, it was the same thing. My favorite GPS app, it's called Waze. Maybe some of you know that too. My Waze app directed me north onto Pinouf and then to San Jose to cross the city to get back home. I watched as car after car impatiently tried to get around buses or the parked cars in the carpool lane to beat ahead of the traffic. I also noticed that few of these cars that did that got very far ahead, despite the risks that they took to weave in and out of the rest of us. It reminded me of one of Aesop's wonderful fables about the hare and the tortoise. Do you know that one? Sometimes it's slow and steady that will win the race, despite all evidence to the contrary. You know, you can learn a lot about human nature from the driver's seat of a car, both about your own nature and that of other drivers around you. Some people are just impatient. They'll take any chance to get ahead of others, even though it doesn't usually get them that far. Now, I know about this from firsthand experience. Once known for pushing the envelope through yellow lights, yes, even me, I had an epiphany one day. I realized, well, okay, at least in the city, any speeding you do is just going to get you to the next red light sooner. Has anyone else experienced that? Okay, yeah, a few people here. It's not rocket science, but did I figure that out in this sometimes thick head of mine? I tend to be overconfident as a driver. I remember my driving exam as a high school student, a teenager, back oh so many years ago. The guy who did the driving test with me in my car, he passed me, but he said that he almost didn't because of my overconfidence. Oh, was I ever glad to hear that he passed me, I was going to get my license. But the risks I would continue to take just within, he told me, the bounds of safety might one day catch up with me. Oh, well, I was reminded of my, shall I say, less than humble approach to driving a car. I was reminded of that by Jeremiah's words, accusing the people of Jacob and Israel of kind of doing the same. Clearly, they or their leaders were getting a little overconfident that they could go their own way in being God's chosen nation, driving the affairs of the people while forgetting about the source of who they were and the purpose for who they were. Jeremiah was worried with others about the kings of the day making alliances with foreign powers, people who worshiped other gods. Perhaps Jeremiah was like my driving instructor, my driving examiner, reminding the people of all the good God had done for them, and not to forget, lest they get caught out for speeding, or worse, to cause an accident. Ah! Jeremiah uses the amazingly vivid image of a cracked cistern. A cracked cistern. It's extreme language meant to get people's attention. A cracked cistern, you bury it in the ground. It's expensive if you have to go back in and repair it. A cracked cistern can hold no water. It means it's no good for anyone, especially if the water you're wasting is God's fountain of living water. The messages to the houses of Jacob and Israel seem to be this: come back to the glory that I give you so freely, says God. Come back to realize the grace of this good, watered, and fertile land. Remember to be grateful to the one who shows you kindness, the one who gives you everything. It's so true that we can be our own worst enemies at times. In our need to succeed, we think we can do it all ourselves, thank you, all on our own merit, forgetting to thank the people or the God, our God, who helped us become who we are. Luke's Jesus, too, is quick to teach a lesson about the place of humility among God's children. He often calls out the kings and the priests, the ministers, expecting and getting the prime seats in any banquet hall, showing off their status, their privilege, their wealth, when he knows, Jesus knows, that God doesn't care about any of that. Jesus' parable about the guest who assumes a place at the head table, only to be asked later to sit down a peg or two with all of the guests witnessing his humiliation. It's a case in point. Jesus here acts like that police officer who witnesses those cars I described to you in my drive home yesterday. Those cars weaving in and out of traffic to gain some slight advantage. When those blue and red lights start to flash, I'm sure that's never happened to any of you here. Oh my goodness, you know immediately the folly of trying to save time getting home that way. Maybe it's just me. In Jesus's eyes, it seems there are only two classes of people who get what the kingdom is all about. The two classes of people are those who have nothing. Think about that. Those that have nothing, the last and the least. The others class of people are simply those who help and serve those others. Two classes of people that get what the kingdom is all about. Those who have nothing, the sick, the lame, the poor, the imprisoned, the homeless, and those who help and serve them. Isn't that something? In Jesus's eyes, all of our striving for status and privilege and wealth and power gains us little actual advantage if we obtain these things without humble hearts. Hearts that know we are no better or worse in God's eyes than those we would count as the poorest of the poor. And Jesus offers us a radical way to remember this. When you give a banquet, he says, invite those who cannot repay you. Slow down, in other words, pay attention to the rules of the road. Act with kindness towards someone in need, because that person, no matter their condition, is worthy of your time, your attention, your care, your help. And in some way, they will reflect God's glory back upon you. By serving each other, Jesus seems to suggest that we all get repaid. We all get home to God together. One last takeaway from Jesus' stories today. I like this one. Give parties. Yeah, let's big applause there, Jesus. Thank you. Hold dinners for people, for friends, for strangers. In COVID times, we've sort of gotten away from that. We need to be careful. Invite people to your homes or out to a park, have a picnic. Eat, drink, and be merry. We know that's Jesus's way, right? God's life is one of joy, abundance meant to be shared. Few will refuse your invitation to get together. If there's someone maybe you haven't been getting along with lately, well, how about invite them too? It won't always work out, but God will smile if you make the attempt to make peace. So friends, you know, in the end, I did pass my driver's practical exam just by a whisker, and I got my license. For those of you who drive, you will remember too the amazing feeling, and here it is, the amazing feeling of holding that piece of laminated freedom in your hands. As I grow older, I have learned that such freedom comes with responsibility to yourself and to others on the road. Perhaps you've learned that in your lives in your own way as well. God values the wisdom we gain by remembering humility, even as we strive to do and learn and grow and play and achieve in this life. It can make all our cisterns, well, a little bit less leaky, maybe, to hold on to and share more of that living water God so much wants us all to have and enjoy. And much, much too slowly, it's made me a better driver. Do I hear an amen? Amen. Especially from Julia here, who is with me in the car a lot. Friends, indeed, thanks be to God. Amen. We sing a song that makes us so humble as we channel God's peace together. Make me a channel of your peace. 684, if you have a hymnal at home, let us sing and rise as able. Channel of your peace.
Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord. And where there's doubt, true faith in you. O Master, grant that I may never seek so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there's despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there's sadness, ever joy. O Master, grant that I may never seek so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, in giving of ourselves that we receive, and in dying that we're born to eternal life.
Amen.
And now our invitation to the offering. Let us make our offering in response to God's goodness, and with concern for our sisters and brothers who are in the church and around the world. You may make your offering by check sent to your church, by e-transfer, or by PAR, the pre-authorized remittance program of your local church.
In the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. And we pray that all unity may one day be restored, and they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will walk with each other, we will walk side by side. We will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand. And together we'll spread the news that God is in this land. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will work with each other, we will work side by side. We will work with each other, we will work side by side. And we'll guard each one's dignity and save each one's pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Our prayer of dedication, let us pray together. Merciful God, give us the same attitude as Jesus, who emptied himself and was obedient to you all the way to the cross. Make us eager to put others before ourselves and their needs before our wants. We ask this through Jesus Christ, your Son, who came that we may live and share our best selves. Amen.
Amen. And as we come to the prayers of the people, I would invite anyone who wishes to add anyone's names for prayers at this time, feel free to add it in the chat and we will include it during our prayers for the people. Let us pray. God, like the Israelites in the wilderness, we too have known your love and experienced your care and provision. You invite us to extend that love to the world around us, to care for others as deeply as we care for ourselves. And so we bring the needs of our world before you now. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for the many who do not have enough food to eat, or shelter to keep warm, enough employment, or money to pay their bills, enough medicine, or medical care. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We also pray for those who have more than enough, but who still struggle to find meaning and purpose in life, who indulge in dangerous or self-serving activities to dull their pain or loneliness. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for those whom we now name before you.
We pray for Carol V, Gladys Snellgrove, Sandy, Rob, and Elizabeth, Martin and Joanne, and especially Dave, for Tristan, Tina, Ted, for Gay Elkis and Erica Gazelle. Hear our prayer.
God, your grace reaches out to all of us. You call us to live as citizens of heaven, working together with one heart and mind. Strengthen us to live in a manner worthy of the good news we have received, offering our lives in service of your kingdom, where the last are first and the first are last, and there is grace enough for all. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer. These and all our prayers we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Our last hymn is Go Make a Difference. It's 209 in More Voices.
Go make a difference. We can make a difference. Go
Oh, what a perfect song to end as we sing together this beautiful words of going to make a difference in the world. Friends, we go knowing the Spirit of Christ goes with us, keeping us safe on the roads as we drive, as we're in our buses, on our metros, all the ways we get through this city, no matter what is going on. With God, we will get home safely together. I will see you all very soon, sooner than you think. Amen. God of hope go with us every day, filling all our lives with love and joy and peace. May the God of justice speed us on our way, bringing light and hope to every land and race. Praying, let us work for peace. Singing, share our joy with all. Working for a world that's new, faithful when we hear Christ call. May the God of healing free the earth from fear, freeing us for peace both treasured and pursued. May the God of love keep our commitment clear, to a world restored, to human life renewed. Praying, let us work for peace. Singing, share our joy with all. Working for a world that's new, faithful when we hear Christ call. Do I hear an amen? Amen. Oh, thank you all for joining us here in our continuing series of joint worship with our friends at Mount Royal United Church and Hudson Wyman. My personal thanks to my colleagues, Ken Chown and David Klinker, for carrying this beautiful ministry with our friends here, Rosemary and Gary and Michaela, and all of you from our pastoral charge that have helped while I have been away and am going away. So wonderful to be together with all of you. And we have this beautiful music to lead us out. Let us enjoy it now. You may be seated. Beautiful, as always. I know lots of us were singing here along with Michelle. Hope you were at home too. We have a time to have some coffee time. We might have time for one more song. What would that be, Rosemary? Oh, I guess there are a number of August and September birthdays, are there? Maybe Mount Royal and Hudson also have some summer and fall birthdays. What are we going to sing? Oh.
That's interesting.
Well, let us sing.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. May God's rich of blessings descend upon you and many more.
Oh my goodness. Thank you. Well, let's go into the grid and find out who has birthdays in this August. Yeah, Sarah's birthday is Monday. My birthday was yesterday. Beverly was Friday. David was Thursday.
And mine is today.
Oh. Was that Giselin?
That's Giselin.
Oh,